the risk is high. I mean, you know,
what's the risk?
Death, dismemberment, paralysis.
Looking ahead at the Pyeongchang Games, what are your thoughts on just the upcoming games generally?
I mean, it's going to be exciting. You know, I'm excited to go and commentate. It's, you know, it'll be my first one where I'm not competing, which will be fun. You know, the Olympics are great to watch. I love watching the Summer Olympics, but the Winter Olympics has a special, you know, role in my life, and it'll be cool to be there and be able to experience it in a different way.
What are your plans for the Olympics as a broadcaster?
I try to keep it exciting and try to make it fun for people to watch. I think it's, you know, it's not a hard sell. The Olympics is pretty easy to watch anyway, but there's a lot of people who do watch the Olympics who don't watch World Cup or any other sports really on a regular basis. So, you know, you have to kind of think about that, and you have to speak to those people a little bit while not talking dumb to the people who are experts or who follow the racing all the time. So that is a little bit of a different challenge.
The U.S., I believe, won 124 winter medals from 02, or since 2002, which is more than powerhouses like Germany and Norway. Why do you think the U.S. has been able to do it?
I mean, we're big event skiers in the U.S. You know, we have a sort of an edge in that regard. I think we're less successful in the daily grind of World Cup, but I think the American sort of mentality suits big events. It suits taking big risk and kind of, you know, being a little bit more flamboyant, really kind of rising to the occasion.
What do you think of the talent pool for the upcoming games?
I can't say I have a perfect handle on it, but I think, you know, it's a challenge right now. We're in a phase where maybe we're not as strong or as experienced, but, you know, with athletes like Lindsay or Ted, I mean, there's no denying that they have the ability to, you know, to win and could potentially be, you know, multiple medal winners there.
I mean, there does seem to be some general concern that there's been a noticeable drop-off in talent. Like, why do you think that is?
I don't think it's a drop-off in talent. I think it's a drop-off in results. You know, okay. There's a big difference between talent and results. But, you know, overall, the World Cup right now, I think, is struggling a little bit with the quality of the intensity. You know, there is no Hermann Meyer out there right now, and or Bodie Miller out there right now. So it is a little bit different. The no question, the level of skill is there. The athletes are exceptionally well conditioned. I just think some of that is mentality and coaching and things like that. And I think it's cyclical. It goes in these big patterns. So on the U.S. team right now, we have a lot of talent. I just don't think we have maybe the experience that we had from myself, Darren, Lindsay, Ted. I don't know that has been translated down to the younger athletes so that they can really learn from it effectively. And that's, you know, that's a real tough thing to try to figure out.
What's the chance of your mind somehow changing and you competing in the 2018 Olympics?
Less than zero. Is there such a thing?
If you wanted to, do you think you could get in shape for the 2018 Olympics?
2018? Yeah, probably. I mean, starting right now, probably it would be tough. It would be one of those times where, as I did in 2015, where I sort of didn't really worry about the races in the beginning of the season and just tried to prepare for World Championships in Vail. And I was definitely very fit by the time Vail came around. You know, it takes a few months, but I'd be able to get there in terms of what I could do physically.
Why not give it one last go?
It's just too much risk. There's no reward. The reward isn't there for me. I've already done it before. Competing again, you know, I don't think it would bring anything, and the risk is high. I mean, you know,
what's the risk?
Death, dismemberment, paralysis, everything.
Do you really think about that?
Of course you do. I mean, it's part of the sport. It's the nature of it. If it was pool, or if it was bowling, or, you know, even golf or tennis, you could there's no real life-threatening thing there. I'd sure you give it a shot. You train and see what happens and just go for it. But skiing is not those sports. It's, you know, just going out of the start gate in an Olympic race in downhill or super G. You know, in GS even you're more or less risking, you know, back injuries, knee injuries, shoulders, things that, you know, you're going to want to use for the rest of your life. But in downhill super G, you really are risking, you're risking your life. And I know the way that I win, I know the way that I compete, I'd have to be taking a lot of risk to do that. It's just, yeah, there's no way to balance that out in my mind.
Do you think any part of you will miss not being there competing?
No, I don't think so. I mean, for people who haven't done it, there's pluses to it, but there's a lot of minuses. It's incredibly stressful. It's, you know, you have to pay attention to a lot of small variables that aren't really fun to pay attention to.
Like what?
Diet, sleep, routines, schedules, training, the prep period, all the stuff. It's a really aggressive program to go into, and it's,
yeah, but
there's,
I
lots
mean,
of it that's not fun at all.
Okay, but you think about it. I mean, wasn't it the last Olympics? I mean, 5 months out, you make the decision to come back and start grinding away.
I was still racing at the time. I mean, it was. I was right still, you know, doing the whole ski team program. It was just a matter of, that was perception and media more than anything else. But yeah.
I mean, I guess all I'm saying is, like, I mean, between now and then, isn't that long of a period of time to for the
after being grind out of the sport for 2 years? It's pretty long. You know,
got it.
If I had just finished a season in March or whatever, then it wouldn't be as big of a deal. But having not raced World Cup in 2 years, it's pretty extreme.
You said before the Olympics are impure. Your intentions behind competing in the Olympics are impure. To what extent have your feelings about the Olympic Games, though, changed over the years?
I don't know. I guess I don't think they've changed that much. I mean, there's parts of that. I guess, you know, it's more than changing. You just refine what it is you see. I mean, the idea of the Olympics is pure. I mean, that's the pure part, is that, you know, the pursuit of that kind of excellence, the desire to remove all the cultural barriers that the world has and come together in sport and, you know, all that crap is definitely, that's the pure part of it. The actual, in reality, the bribery, the scandals that are involved with the Olympic Committee, the blatant embezzlement of money and that go around, you know, I mean, talk about this last Olympics in Sochi. I mean, who knows how many deaths there were around that Olympic movement. I mean, that stuff is what I mean by impure. And the, you know, I think there's that's always in conflict. I mean, reality versus imaginary. And I think the imaginary version is the important one, really, at this point. And then embracing that imaginary version and watching the reality and try to make the two connect and living that little bit of the inspirational dream in real life. You know, picking out the parts that work for you.